free speech zone time again. And, well, once in a blue moon, well, actually a little more frequently than that, we have an extra show in a month. So we had 5 Saturdays in July, I guess. Anyway, but what's a blue moon? Well, here's a clip from NASA, NASA. Did I get that right? Yeah, NASA, National Aeronautics and Space Administration. And they're going to explain, this is just a little quickie about what is a blue moon. Let's hear it.
Summer Blue Moon, presented by Science at NASA. When someone says once in a blue moon, you know what they mean. Rare, seldom, even absurd. This year, it means the end of July. For the second time this month, the moon is about to become full. There was one full moon on July 2nd, and now a second is coming on July 31st. According to modern folklore, whenever there are 2 full moons in a calendar month, the second one is blue. This definition of a blue moon is a recent thing. If you told a person in Shakespeare's day that something happens once in a blue moon, they would attach no astronomical meaning to the statement. Blue moon simply meant rare or absurd, like making a date for the 12th of never. Since then, however, its meaning has shifted. The modern definition sprang up in the 1940s. In those days, the Maine Farmer's Almanac offered a definition of blue moon so convoluted, many astronomers struggled to understand it. It involved factors such as ecclesiastical dates of Easter and Lent, tropical years, and the timing of seasons according to the dynamical mean sun. Aiming to explain blue moons to the layman, Sky and Telescope published an article in 1946 entitled Once in a Blue Moon. The author, James Hugh Pruitt, cited the 1937 Maine Almanac and opined that the second full moon in a month, so I interpret it, is called blue moon. That was not correct, but at least it could be understood, and thus the modern blue moon was born. Most blue moons look pale gray and white, just like the moon you've seen on any other night. Squeezing a second full moon into a calendar month doesn't change its color. Nevertheless, on rare occasions, the moon can turn blue. A truly blue moon usually requires a volcanic eruption. Back in 1883, for example, people saw blue moons almost every night after the Indonesian volcano Krakatoa exploded with the force of a 100-megaton nuclear bomb. Plumes of ash rose to the very top of Earth's atmosphere, and the moon? It turned blue. Krakatoa's ash was the reason. Some of the plumes were filled with particles 1 micron wide, about the same as the wavelength of red light. Particles of this special size strongly scatter red light, while allowing blue light to pass through. Krakatoa's clouds thus acted like a blue filter. People also saw blue-colored moons in 1983 after the eruption of the El Chichon volcano in Mexico. And there are reports of blue moons caused by Mount St. Helens in 1980 and Mount Pinatubo in 1991. Forest fires can do the same trick. A famous example is the giant muskeg fire of September 1953 in Alberta, Canada. Clouds of smoke containing micron-sized oil droplets produced lavender suns and blue moons all the way from North America to England. At this time of year, summer wildfires often produce smoke with an abundance of micron-sized particles, just the right size to turn the moon truly blue. On the other hand, maybe it will turn red. Often when the moon is hanging low, it looks red for the same reason that sunsets are red. The atmosphere is full of aerosols, much smaller than the ones injected by volcanoes. These aerosols scatter blue light while leaving the red behind. For this reason, red blue moons are far more common than blue blue moons. Sounds absurd? Yes, but that's what a blue moon is all about. Step outside at sunset on July 31st, look east, and see what color presents itself. For more rare and colorful occurrences on Earth and beyond, stay tuned to science.nasa.gov.
I just cleared my throat right at the wrong time. I'm sure you heard that. Well, okay, now we're going to get into more serious stuff. And one of the things that is happening in the United States is debtor's prison. Now, normally you think of that not being the case in the United States. But more and more, it is. It's a combination of economic pressures, trying to, you know, come up with creative fundraising, things like that. But who's the victim? Well, let's just take a look at this little clip here. It's, you go to prison for being poor.
I'm trying to push it off of my car, then it's
going to
be tore up
anyway. Let us get going.
This is an everyday thing.
Yeah, I probably don't have enough gas, and the starter's gone out of it, so you got to do this every time you want to leave in that car.
And we was just going to the gas station. They pulled us over, and they wrote me a seatbelt ticket, and it came out to be $41. I didn't have no money to pay, so they charged me $10 to put me on JCS probation. And JCS, I don't get why they're in the picture. This is between me and the courts, not another business.
There is an entire industry devoted to making money off of people who can't pay.
Normally, an offender is put on probation to make sure that they're not posing a threat to public safety if they're not going to be put into prison. But we see a lot of courts really just hiring probation companies because they want to hire a debt collector and calling it probation.
Judicial Correction Services is a private company that allegedly provides private probation services. Essentially, they're a collection agency.
Private probation companies don't charge the courts they work for. Instead, they bill the people they supervise directly in fees every month that they're on probation. That's how they make profits. We found widespread abuses plaguing this whole industry, ignoring evidence that people are actually making heroic efforts to pay down their debts.
Is this all the money you got?
All of it.
Being poor has never been a crime in this country.
And yet, we are still throwing people into prison for owing money and not paying it back.
I've heard people going to jail for not paying their fines. That's one thing around here that will get you in jail quick is not paying your probation. They will come get you for that quicker than not paying your child support.
Probation is supposed to be a way to keep people out of prison who don't really belong there. Private probation really turns all of that on its head.
It's essentially a debtor's prison.
Pretty much all of Columbiana's in there.
And just about everybody I know has had to and still are going through it.
Yeah, every time you go to court, it's like a family reunion.
One of the really perverse things is that often the poorest communities are the best markets for them. In a place where people really struggle, people wind up on probation in large numbers and for very long periods of time, and that translates into big money and fees for probation companies.
So when profit becomes the driving force, civil rights get thrown under the bus.
That's just about as far as I can get it from the inside. I have to have help getting it the rest of the way. Columbiana is a very small town. There's just a lot of land and roads, and then like what stores we do have, there's not really that many. I've applied for Fred's, Piggly Wiggly, Target. I would love to have a job. This is why I'm not broke all the time. JCS adds on $35 every month, even if you're making progress on it or not. It's almost impossible when you are 17 with no income. I live with my mom and my sisters and my two nephews, and my mom is on disability. She pays all of the bills, and if she can give me anything, she will give me a little bit to put towards my ticket, but there's usually not much left.
$40 is very hard to come by.
And once you get $40 or something like that around here, usually you put that in gas to get where you need to be.
We're looking at offenders who would not be on probation at all if they had more money. They wind up actually paying more than the person of means over time and is faced with the continual risk of incarceration if they fall behind on their payments.
Here is the actual ticket I got, paid $10, fees $35, and then fine balance $41. And it shows that it went towards my fees and my fine stayed the same. And then this one right here shows I paid another $10. It shows that the fees went down, but fine is still $41.
I've told the judge that I had the money to pay for the ticket,
and I couldn't afford the rest of the fees, and he said that that wasn't his problem, that I could just put that $41 towards the probation.
And then I got another one that shows I paid $41 even, and the fine has not been touched, not one time, all the money I've paid. And see this paper right here, it says a payment is needed. If you fail to appear, a warrant will be issued for your arrest.
A lot of companies in the private probation industry are run by people who are former law enforcement. JCS is run by a man named Robert McMichael, who is a former sheriff and U.S. Marshal. And there's no question that those connections often pave the way to them getting the business that they get.
The system is horribly broken. You can't pay, you're poor, then you're going to be placed in the hands of JCS, threatened with jail, and in many times, jail.
Hundreds of people locked up.
1,000 people every month in Alabama because they cannot
afford to pay. For simply failing to pay.
They all attacked the poor.
It was either pay or go to jail.
They threatened me with jail.
It's not me refusing to pay these tickets because I pay them.
New York Times, quote, there are real constitutional issues at stake.
There are two federal lawsuits that are going on against JCS. We're challenging that whole system, the fact that these people were indigent, that they were forced to pay additional funds, and then were ultimately jailed because they couldn't pay these fines that were demanded by JCS.
I have to go back to court, and I have to figure out how to come up with half of it right then, and I cannot leave the building until I do, or I will be locked up.
I'm not trying to get out of my ticket. I was guilty. I deserve the ticket. But all this probation fees they tack on, I can't afford it. And I'd really like to be able to just pay it and be done with it.
Georgia passed a law transferring probation services to the counties, and that allowed them to privatize their probation services for misdemeanor crimes.
Put behind bars for being poor. That's how a group of local attorneys describe arrest warrants requested by Sentinel Offender Services for misdemeanor offenders.
We're all basically low income. They live paycheck to paycheck. My husband and I, we've been married 32 years. We have two daughters, and that's my younger daughter when she was probably about five. In 2006, I was pulled over for DUI. I was sentenced to Columbia County. I sat there for 8 months. Sentinel put me on 2 years probation. 2008, my probation was over. I paid my fine. In 2012, Labor Day weekend, a police officer pulled in. I was walking my dogs around the front of that trailer. The officer come in here, and he got out, and he asked me to stop. And then he come back saying there was a hold on me in Columbia County. And I said, for what? And he said, violation of probation. I'd been off probation for 4 years. I said, no, officer, I believe you're making a really bad mistake. He says, well, I still have to take her in. And that's when I sat in Columbia County for 20 days. Judge Danny Craig asked Sentinel, why is she still on probation when she was off 4 years ago? And they had took it upon themselves to reinstate me without a judge's order or anything back on probation just to get the monthly fee. He sent me home. I was off of it. But my husband still had to pay $156. Yeah, it makes you scared. You wonder about going in a grocery store or just out walking your dogs. A police officer might come by and arrest you again. I do realize I shouldn't have been drinking and driving and that I did make a mistake and I did pay for it. But they want to drag it out just for their profit. And there's so many out there that they're using like that.
A disabled Augusta veteran locked up because he couldn't pay a fee.
A ticket that turned into jail time and blamed Sentinel Offender Services. Three people currently jailed in Richmond County are joining the legal fight against Sentinel. About 10,000 Richmond County residents with outstanding arrest warrants taken out by Sentinel.
So when I walked out of the courtroom after that 20 days, a lawyer was waiting outside for me. And he said, you know, they were holding you illegally. And I'd like to really talk to you.
So here we are talking about a lady who stayed in the Columbia County jail now for about 20 days at $50 a day. It cost the county $1,000. It cost the lady her freedom so Sentinel could collect $157. I mean, that's what we're dealing with.
Sentinel is a big company, but it's family held. The owner of the company is Bob Contestable. His son, Mark, is largely responsible for running the company's for-profit probation business out of Georgia. Many company officials are quite eager to blame the courts. The reality is that they have an enormous amount of discretion in their day-to-day interactions with the people that they supervise. And many of the decisions they make are not done in consultation with the courts at all. There's a lot of power that the courts delegate, sometimes improperly, to these companies. But the companies have a very direct responsibility for all of this as well.
Wave for the camera. She just got married, she just got back from the Caribbean. So I must pay them okay, because they can do that, right? I'm Dale Allen, I'm the Chief Probation Officer of Athens Clark County Probation Services. Overall, I've been in the criminal justice field for over 35 years. One of the contributing factors to us deciding to transition from private probation to governmental probation was a request of the judges for more accountability, more transparency. We do believe we're 100% transparent. All my records are open, my fines, my fees, where the money goes, my budget is open record. I don't feel any pressure whatsoever to collect a certain amount of fees. We are not here to make a profit. The concept of locking people up for money goes against every instinct I have as a manager of probation. I actually call it the economics of doing the right thing. If they cannot pay, legitimately cannot pay, then it's to our community's best interest, it's to my government's best interest to work with them any way you can, short of incarcerating them.
I think that most people like to imagine that in 21st century America, there's no such thing as a debtor's prison anymore. That's not true. There are people in courts all across this country losing their freedom, not just because they're not able to come up with the money to pay down a fine, but because they're falling behind on payments to a private for-profit company that's been allowed to collect fees from them.
JCS, Sentinel, their interest is to make money, not to serve the judicial system.
Without question, the most urgent need is for laws at the state level that impose strict oversight and accountability on these companies and the situations where they can and should not be able to collect fines from people.
They don't show like they care about people, even if you're trying, you know, to do what's right.
They don't help nobody. There's really no purpose but just for them to get money.
We have to go by the laws, and I feel they ought to too. Who do they have to answer to for doing wrong?
Well, it just shows you there's just one more thing that we shouldn't privatize. I mean, what do we have on that list? Healthcare. Don't privatize healthcare. Don't allow a profit on healthcare. For obvious reasons. I don't understand why people don't understand. Don't privatize water. We know from watching Nestle and the other people drain the aquifers all over the world and the high suicide rate of farmers in India because of that. No, you don't privatize water. What do you want to do, privatize the air? I'm sure they do. Well, and you don't privatize the legal system because that gives them profit incentive to mess with you. Well, are incarcerated people poorer than non-incarcerated people? Here's another point of view. Let's take a look at this one.
Initiative provides the pre-incarceration income of the imprisoned and provides national data on the pre-incarceration income of incarcerated women. Joining us today from East Hampton, Massachusetts, is Bernadette Reboy. Bernadette Reboy joined the Prison Policy Initiative as a policy and communications associate in August 2014. Bernadette was recently on our show to discuss her insightful report, Screening Out Family Time, on the exploitative video visitation industry. Welcome back to the show, Bernadette.
Thanks for having me again.
Okay, so what made you decide to create this report, Prisons of Poverty?
So the idea for the report actually came when I was preparing the report on video visitation in prisons and jails. And when I was doing that report, I needed to show why the rate of $1 per minute for video visitation was simply too high for incarcerated people and their families. But the data that was out there was from 1991. So we decided to use a government data source that was already out there in order to update that figure to something that is now in 2014 dollars, which is much more current, and then for the first time, provide pre-incarceration incomes for incarcerated women.
Does this report cover local, state, and federal institutions?
It only includes state prisons, actually.
Well, what does this report tell us about the incarcerated persons by race, ethnicity, and gender?
What the report shows is that all incarcerated people, whether they are Black, white, Hispanic, or men or women, they all make less than their non-incarcerated counterparts even before they go to prison. So the research has long said that people with criminal records who have served sentences make less after they are released from prison. But what we wanted to show was that these are people who are poorer even before they go to prison.
By the way, we are showing figures 1 and 2 from the report so our audience can see the income levels.
Yes, so you can see from those figures that the incarcerated people make 41% less than the typical non-incarcerated person. And we adjusted these figures by age because we know that people who are incarcerated tend to be younger than the general population. So these figures are for people ages 27 to 41.
So let's work through the report a bit more. With figures 3 and 4, please describe these graphs to our audience.
So figures 3 and 4 show the distribution of incomes of incarcerated people versus non-incarcerated people. What they show is that incarcerated men and women are really concentrated at the lowest incomes, whereas that's definitely not true for men and women who are not incarcerated.
Who did you collaborate with on this report, and what was your methodology?
We collaborated with a data scientist, Daniel Kopp, who is a member of our Young Professionals Network, which is a way for people to be involved through volunteer work or anything that they can do from remotely most of the time. So he's a member of that, and we work together on this because the Bureau of Justice Statistics has this survey, which is what we use to get the data for this report. But the way that it's available online, it's not accessible to the public unless you have specific statistical software. So what we wanted to do was make this data available to people by in a format that people understand and that they can easily read without having to get special software.
It seemed like this required a very careful analysis and interpretation of the stats that make this accessible to the general public.
Yeah, it did. It took a lot of back and forth. For example, adjusting for age was really important. The numbers would have been very different if we hadn't done that. And there were some other things we did with the numbers to make them more accessible. For example, one thing we did is adjust for inflation. So this survey is actually quite old, but unfortunately, it's the most recent data that is available. So the survey was conducted back in 2004, which is kind of old. But unfortunately, the Bureau of Justice Statistics won't be doing another one. And so there won't be newer data for at least another few years. So we adjusted for inflation so that these are in numbers that people understand in today's dollars. And then another thing we did is the survey asked for people's incomes the month before they were incarcerated. So what we did is change those numbers from monthly to annual. So hoping, once again, that people will be able to better understand those numbers.
Well, how do you envision this report being utilized to create effective public policy changes?
So we decided to really make this report as simple as possible with really just one takeaway, which was proving the obvious that incarcerated people are poorer than non-incarcerated people of the same race, ethnicity, or gender, and of similar ages. And we're really hoping that people can take this data and use it for their different causes. For example, one way is hopefully this will add some more urgency to the debates around ending employment discrimination for people with criminal convictions. Another thing that we're really hoping to start the conversation on is how some of these communities where that send the most people to prison or jail have been neglected by our government and our social services. So we're hoping that this report will also add fuel to that conversation about how maybe in some ways our social services and policies failed some of these people before they even went to prison.
Okay, thank you, Bernadette, for joining Al's show, Rattle the Bars. This was very comprehensive.
Thanks so much.
And thank you for joining The Real News.
Okay, now we're going to see a clip from James Corbett, the New World Reading Order. New World Order Reading List. Oh, man, okay, talk about it. Okay, so anyway, this is the reading list, so you can keep up with the New World Order. There you go.
Hello, friends. James Corbett here, CorbettReport.com, with a thought for the day. One of the questions that I get in constantly through the website, and I mean every week without fail, is, James, what books do you recommend reading? And that's just such a large and overwhelming question that my answer tends to be, well, I've recommended hundreds of books, literally hundreds of books over the years. Please go back through the podcast archives and there are plenty of references. But I know that's not satisfying, you want a specific list. So instead of regenerating that list every week, why not just do a video and point people to that? So let's go through some books. And again, this is just a smattering of a sampling of some of the books that I think are worth reading, but these are some of them anyway. And I'll start with one that I'm currently devouring, Myth, Lies, and Oil Wars by William Engdahl, a great researcher and a very valuable book about the oligarchy and how it really functions, including things that that even a lot of the alt media don't really talk about or cover. So very, very important. Lots of valuable information. As you see, I'm only part of the way through the book, but I'm definitely getting a lot of info out of this, and I'm sure that will equate translate into a podcast episode in the near future. Of course, anything by William Engdahl is probably worth reading. Seeds of Destruction, I talk about all the time, is a great example of that. Another person that I think you should be reading, Michelle Chosadovsky, of course, GRTV, Global Research. He has lots of books. His latest is The Globalization of War, but this is one, I think, from the 1980s, The Globalization of Poverty and the New World Order. Great book with lots of good, solid, hard data about various countries in Africa and Asia and how they have been usurped by the IMF World Bank hegemon. Very, very interesting information there. Guest that I've had on numerous times on the podcast now, James Perloff. Of course, the best book on the Council on Foreign Relations you're ever going to read, The Shadows of Power. Absolute must read. On the 9/11 subject, Mark Gaffney, Black 9/11, one of the few books actually dealing with the billions of dollars, at least, that were swindled on 9/11 itself. Very, very important, the money trail of 9/11, as I constantly stress. Excellent, slim little volume here on the anthrax deception, the 2001 anthrax deception by Graeme McQueen. Great little book. Please listen to my interview with him where we go through some of the details, but I definitely recommend this. It's as I say, a very slim volume, but gets to the point and says it in a very compelling manner. Any number of other books that we're leaving out here that I don't physically have with me. Patrick Wood's Technocracy Rising, of course, must read. I hope people will get that. On the fiction side of things, because it's not all nonfiction all the time, people might remember I recently talked to Simon Crims of SimonCrims.com. I don't remember if that's his website, so I'll put that in the show notes so that you can find it. But of course, he did Roller Dog, which is a children's book, an illustrated children's book, with lots of very lushly detailed illustrations of various, well, things exposing the New World Order in various ways. Very, very interesting, and so much detail in these pictures. You literally can spend... Well, I've spent hours going through this book with my son, and absolutely, there's so much detail in here. And actually, Simon also sent me the original print of this particular Congress critter depiction, which I found quite compelling in a strange way. So thank you for that, Simon. I do appreciate that. I hope people will check out that book. It's available as a free PDF or ebook download, but you can, of course, also order the physical copy, which I suggest you do. Also on the fiction note, Sibel Edmonds, The Lone Gladio. I know I talked about it when it came out. I hope you had a chance to read it. If not, please do. It's fiction about Gladio B, and it's such a compelling read. It really is a very interesting novel in and of itself, let alone all of the details that it's revealing about Gladio B, the very real details of the very real Gladio B program, couched in fiction, so that, you know, it's compelling, and it's a great way to introduce this to other people who might never, ever look into such subjects. Of course, Sibel Edmonds' Classified Woman is also a must-read if you're into the nonfiction side of what she actually did at her time in the FBI and then her case afterwards, fighting with the FBI. And getting completely off of the truth subjects, I guess, people always ask me also about my personal literary tastes. Of course, that's the thing I was actually trained in. That's my education background. So, for my money, best book of the English language, William Faulkner, Absalom, Absalom. It is not for everyone. It is a very difficult read, but I love it. I love it, but most people won't, so don't take it as a recommendation. I don't want to be blamed for it when you don't like it. And best book in any language ever. I don't know, that's a pretty tall order, but one that I started about, I don't know, probably 12 or 13, no, maybe 14 or 15 years ago at this point. Still haven't completed. In Search of Lost Time, La Recherche de Temps Perdu by Marcel Proust. It's beautiful. It's exquisitely written. It's wonderful. Again, it's not for most people. Most people would find it horribly boring or whatever, but I love it. I'm on volume 5, and it's took me 15 years to get here. It's a 3,000-page novel, so take your time. Maybe make it a lifelong quest. Anyway, those are just a handful, a smattering, a sampling of some suggestions of what to read. But as I say, really, I have recommended hundreds of books over the years, so please go back through the archives, and when you're listening to a podcast and you hear a good book recommendation, write it down. That's it for today. Thank you, as always, for tuning in. I'm going to talk to you again real soon. James Corbett, CorbettReport.com.
Okay, well, I learned how to speed read reading War and Peace. You know, okay, well, anyway... we're going to go on now, and we're going to see how InfoWars sums up the history of John McCain. Let's listen to this one.
John McCain has had a long career, and that career has been stained by one awful mess after another. Whether it's his skin-saving leak to reporters during the Keating 5 corruption scandal.
Charles Keating was the flamboyant owner of the risk-taking Lincoln Savings and Loan, whose failure eventually cost taxpayers $3.4 billion.
It was a very, very close personal relationship. The family spent a lot of time together. They traveled so often together with the Keating family, flying to their place in the Bahamas.
On judgment, ethics, and truthfulness, he failed this test as badly as you can fail.
Can't trust Obama.
Or the now obvious boost he gave to Barack Obama's presidential bid.
He's an Arab. He is not.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
No?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am. No, ma'am. He's a decent family man, citizen that I just happen to have disagreements with on fundamental issues, and that's what this campaign is all about. He's not. Thank you.
It's not only what you do in politics, it's what you appear to do.
Peering behind the truth of McCain's media facade as a war hero.
You do not think that is a war hero, captured or not?
I didn't see anything differently. And if you read and if you watch and take a look at what you have, I said nothing differently. I'm very disappointed in John McCain because the vets are horribly treated in this country.
While going to great political lengths to hide all of the information needed by now countless American families to discover the truth in what Pulitzer Prize winning author Sidney H. Shanberg described in a 2008 issue of The Nation as a telling mass of official documents, radio intercepts, witness depositions, satellite photos of rescue symbols that pilots were trained to use, electronic messages from the ground containing the individual code numbers given to the airmen, a rescue mission by a special forces unit that was aborted twice by Washington, and even sworn testimony by two defense secretaries that men were left behind. John McCain spent his time at the Hau Lo prison, aka the Hanoi Hilton, staring at death's door until his status as a POW was upgraded because McCain's father was a top admiral. After the signing of the January 1973 peace treaty,
by joint agreement, the full text of the agreement and the protocols to carry it out will be issued tomorrow.
Hanoi released 591 detainees. John McCain was one of them. In 1991, McCain was appointed as chairman of the Senate Select Committee on POW-MIA Affairs due to the fact that internal Pentagon whistleblowers had been complaining for years that significant information was being withheld regarding the POWs. McCain would use this committee to cover up the truth all the way until today, following a pattern constructed by the White House since old Tricky Dick Nixon took office. Sidney H. Shanberg continues, included in the evidence that McCain and his government allies suppressed or sought to discredit is a transcript of a senior North Vietnamese general's briefing of the Hanoi Politburo, discovered in Soviet archives by an American scholar in 1993. The briefing took place only 4 months before the 1973 peace accords. The general, Tran Van Quang, told the Politburo members that Hanoi was holding 1,205 American prisoners, but would keep many of them at war's end as leverage to ensure getting war reparations from Washington. There's no telling how many POWs have died since 1973 waiting for our leaders to bargain them out of those nightmarish conditions. True unknown soldiers that may even be alive today. John Bound for InfoWars.com.
Okay, now I'm trying to squeeze as much as we can in, so we're going to go right to the next one. This was a short history of Black Lives Matter.
What's up, world, and welcome to another edition of I Mix What I Like here at the Real News Network. I'm Jared Ball in Baltimore. After the 2012 killing of Trayvon Martin, three black women, Alicia Garza, Opal Tometi, and our guest this segment, Patrice Cullors, formed what has since become the global phenomenon of Black Lives Matter. Patrice Cullors is an artist, organizer, and freedom fighter. She is also founder of Dignity and Power Now, and she has worked tirelessly promoting law enforcement accountability and continues to as my main man, Peace Justice Universal, AKA DJ U-Rock, AKA Pedro, used to say, upset the setup. Patrice Cullors, welcome to the show. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
So Patrice, for those who may have just been introduced to you in a most direct way at the Netroots conference intervention you conducted, please help them and us see past what appears from my point of view to have been a tremendous amount of appropriation and suppression of you, Opal, and Alicia as founders, and the particular brand of radical black gender and sexuality politics you all work with. So if you would, please summarize for us how you see the origins, politics, and purpose of Black Lives Matter.
I think that's a great question. And the first place I'll go is the origins come from a deep place of black love and black rage. Both Alicia, myself, and Opal feeling the impact of George Zimmerman being acquitted of Trayvon Martin's murder, what that actually meant for our society, what that meant for this country to allow for this light-skinned, white-passing man to kill a young boy and get away with it. We knew this was going to have consequences far greater than that current moment. And so Black Lives Matter originates from a need to intervene in a 500-year story and plan to kill and create havoc and chaos in Black people's lives. We believe that we are in a state of emergency. And that state of emergency looks like a crisis in the Black community at some of the highest levels, being murdered by the state, incarcerated at some of the highest rates, being unemployed at some of the highest rates, our inability to live a life of dignity. And so Black Lives Matter was a call for all Black lives. And it was important for us as Black women, and two of which are queer, was to actually talk about the totality of Black life, and that Black cis men are not the sum of Black people, but rather all Black life being the totality of Black people, whether that's Black trans folk, whether that's Black folks who've been incarcerated, whether that's Black folks who are currently incarcerated, Black folks with disabilities. We wanted to call a new Black liberation movement that centered those most at the margin as a part of a political frame to challenge the current system that we live in.
You know, so as I said a little bit in the intro, there has been some struggle over, frankly, Black men in particular, assuming leadership of Black Lives Matter. And I know you've all had to put out a statement in at least one instance to address one specific occurrence of this. But if you could say a word or two about that particular phenomenon, as well as I would extend it to the broader phenomenon of other groups co-opting, as I'm calling it at least, the phrase Black Lives Matter. You have All Lives Matter has been one of the popularly used hashtags. Then you've had even the police marching,
calling together,
for Blue Lives Matter,
to the officers that,
and many others and that are not even meaning to be disrespectful, I think, perhaps. But how have you dealt with, or how are you all as a collective dealing with this again, what I'm calling a co-optation or an appropriation of Black Lives Matter?
Yes, we put out a frame very early on, after the killing of Mike Brown, when the hashtag went viral, that Black Lives Matter as a project, as a political project, as an organizing project, was to remain as Black Lives Matter. And we requested amongst our allies in particular to not change the hashtag, and that this is a moment where we get to center the devaluing of Black life and the resilience of Black life. And that when we use things like All Lives Matter, or when we say things like Our Lives Matter, that we're actually negating Black life, whether that's intentionally or unintentionally. And I think that how we've talked to our non-Black POC allies have also engaged them to think about other ways to speak on their issues, their particular issues. Let's be creative about the hashtags we use and not co-opt the one that's really been about the fight for Black life.
Mm-hmm. You know, some people, including, you know, we have a number of people have reached out, including a political prisoner, Jalil Muntakin, who has written from behind the prison walls trying to reach out to Black Lives Matter activists and others. And one of the critiques that he shared, a loving critique, as I would want to point out, by the way, is that he was concerned or is concerned that that there's a lack of perhaps ideological direction in Black Lives Matter that would allow it to be to fizzle out, and as he said, in comparison to Occupy Wall Street. As you are advanced in your own organization, as you all are headed to Cleveland to participate in this Black Lives Movement conference, how do you respond to that particular critique? Again, a loving critique from an elder of the struggle, that some others share, that I've even shared as well, to be frank, as a concern about, in part because of the co-optation and the appropriation, that a more clear ideological structuring might be of some value here. But how do you respond to those kinds of, again, loving criticisms?
I think that the criticism is helpful. I also think that it might... I think of a lot of things. The first thing I think is that we actually do have an ideological frame. Myself and Alicia in particular are trained organizers. We are trained Marxists. We are super versed on sort of ideological theories. And I think that what we really try to do is build a movement that could be utilized by many, many Black folk. We don't necessarily want to be the vanguard of this movement. I think we've tried to put out a political frame that's about centering who we think are the most vulnerable amongst the Black community to really fight for all of our lives. And I do think that we have some clear direction around where we want to take this movement. I don't believe it's going to fizzle out. It just gets stronger and we see it, right? We've seen it after Sandra Bland. We're seeing it now with the interruption of the Netroots Nation Presidential Forum. What I do think, though, is folks, especially folks who've been trained in a particular way, want to hear certain things from us that we're not sort of framing it in the same ways that maybe another generation has. But I think it's important that people know that we are the Black Lives Matter movement doesn't just live online. Although there's many people who utilize it online, we're in a different set of circumstances, a different generation that social media may feel like it's diluting sort of the larger ideological frame, but I argue that it's not.
No, I think that's very well said, very well taken, understood. And as, you know, speaking for myself, it was just an intent or a desire to encourage that it not fizzle out. So I'm glad to hear you saying that, and I'm happy that that there appears to be much more going on than some of us are aware of, particularly those who are, again, politically incarcerated, as is Jahlil Muntakeen. One last question, if I could, real quick. There has been some controversy in some circles over the definition of Black. Could you say a word or two about how you conceive the term Black and what you mean when you say Black Lives Matter?
Black to me is both about a race that's been constructed, but it's also a political statement. It's a political framework. And I think it's important as we are building out this movement for Black liberation that we in the Black Lives Matter movement allow for necessary debate to come up around how we use the term and who's using the term and when it's used and why it's an important point to sort of build people together. And I think it's specifically important when it comes to how the U.S. is very clever at turning other groups white, right, and making them white. And we've seen that throughout history when groups were not white and when the white power structure was threatened, they figured out a way to make groups white. And I think as we move forward, we have to figure out political alignments that hold Blackness as a broader framework than just sort of the skin we're in, but as a political statement.
Patrice Cullors, thank you very much for joining us in this segment of I Mix What I Like for the Real News Network.
Thank you.
And thank you all for joining us here as well. And for all involved, I'm Jared Ball here in Baltimore. And as always, as Fred Hampton used to say, to you we say peace if you're willing to fight for it. Peace. Everybody, catch you in a whirlwind. And as of course, as we just covered, Black lives do matter. Peace, everybody.
Peace. Okay, now we're going to go right into another one. This one's about what happens when corporations spy on Americans. And then we're going to go out with this one a little bit short. Sorry about that. Watch it on YouTube. And I'll see you next week.
How do you know when the national security state has gotten completely out of control? Welcome to the Henry A. Wallace National Security Forum. I'm Sonali Kohatkar. The NSA, Pentagon, and other security agencies rely on outside private contractors to do a lot of their work. Those companies have become experts in spying on US citizens. That's scary enough. But what if they now had new clients? What if big corporations could use them to spy on activists opposing their harmful actions? Heidi Boghossian is a lawyer, radio host, and executive director of the A.J. Must Memorial Institute, which has focused on supporting nonviolence and social justice since 1974. She has defended several people against this type of spying, and she now joins us from New York. Welcome to the program, Heidi.
Great to be here.
Well, can you begin by telling us what the relationship is between the private security sector and the national security state here in the United States?
U.S. intelligence agencies and the private sector in this country work so closely together that they're virtually indistinguishable. They share resources, they share personnel in terms of really a revolving door between government leaders of these agencies who then go to work for the private sector, then come back to work for government, and often advise the president and the national security leaders on policy and who to contract with. So it's rife with conflicts of interest and really blurred lines between the two sectors.
Now, do the same regulations that apply to national security agencies of the government also apply to private contractors?
Private corporations aren't bound by the U.S. Constitution. So the kind of spying, the in-depth monitoring that they can and do conduct on activists and ordinary Americans is really without oversight and without the kind of rules that government intelligence agencies are supposed to follow.
And how do private companies influence our laws and our policies? One of the institutions that we now know today is quite active and has been active over the years is ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Council, which is an organization that influences legislation at the state level by being able to meet directly with state representatives. And some of the policies that they recommend that are then implemented, passed and implemented, involve national security. So how much influence do they have in crafting our policies and our laws?
ALEC has an enormous amount of influence. They actually draft model legislation, so they will put their full force behind getting legislators to approve laws that they draft. We've seen state laws, anti-terrorism laws, that have also passed on a federal level, such as the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act. And I think the danger is that when you have corporations writing our laws and doing so because they have a vested interest in protecting their bottom line, for example, it's very easy for them to target lawful activities of Americans, but to craft it in a way that makes ordinary activities such as leafleting or boycotting an industry that, say, treats animals inhumanely, they call that terrorism, and I think that's an enormous danger when it's motivated by a for-profit company who's not accountable to the general public.
Now, we know today that the national security framework is used at all levels to justify all sorts of infringements of our rights. Local police departments, for example, are spending a lot of money on national security related enhancements to their police equipment and how they go about gathering intelligence. Tell us a little bit about this sort of mini industry that is built up in local police departments. How lucrative is it? How much funding do they get? And does that funding in the end go back to the very same private companies that write the laws requiring these sorts of things?
After the events of 9/11, the Department of Homeland Security created many incentives for local police departments across the country to apply for grants to really bolster their police departments, whether it be by adding equipment, in some cases military tanks, as well as other funds that they could then keep and sort of make permanent in their departments if they identified local terrorism threat assessments. And what we saw across the country were departments really rushing to come up with threat assessments. In many cases, there were websites by law enforcement that encouraged people to identify local activists and any kind of event that might attract a diverse group of people to call that the potential for terrorism. And we saw over $34 billion being poured into police departments for that kind of thing.
Tell us a little bit about so-called fusion centers. A lot of Americans don't even know what these are, but they exist around the country post 9/11. What are fusion centers and how did they fit within this network we've been talking about?
Well, between the years 2003 and 2007, the government realized it really had to step up its efforts to coordinate and streamline intelligence gathering. It was criticized for how it handled the events of 9/11. There was a lot of waste in government and no transparency. So they created fusion centers, and there are about 73 across the country. But what they do is they again streamline the sharing of information between law enforcement, intelligence agencies, and again, the private sector, big business.
On the issue of how activism can be targeted, let's look at the example of the Occupy Wall Street protests. That was a very large mobilization of activists around the country. And in that case, how did private security companies cooperate with local police departments and the national security state to spy on these activists, to undermine their work?
A month or so actually before the first Occupy encampment in New York, the Department of Homeland Security actually knew about it and started reaching out aggressively to financial institutions and banks in New York City and also across the nation. Word quickly spread, and the Department of Homeland Security started monitoring activists who had been active before and who I believe they suspected would be active in Occupy. And it's worth noting that there was a concerted effort really to keep the media out of the several times when police went in and shut encampments down in New York in the middle of the night and elsewhere around the nation. I think it was because they shared intelligence so effectively, even those just camping out on the streets in front of their banks, but also to share that database with others across the country in a well-coordinated effort.
What is the danger to a democratic society when you have a national security state that punishes dissent, that undermines free speech, and that works in such close concert with private companies?
The danger is that anyone who acts differently, who challenges the status quo, who may engage in a creative form of protest to get a message out, is labeled and stigmatized as a would-be terrorist. Often, ordinary activists going to what we call national special security events, such as the Republican National Convention, the Democratic Convention, are targeted months before they go to such event because law enforcement has records on them. Their homes may be visited by the FBI asking questions of friends and family. Their offices may be visited. And what happens is, it has what we call a chilling effect on the exercise of free speech. People become afraid when they know the FBI has visited their home of what might happen.